More than 2 million Iraqis have fled the country since the war began there in 2003. Almost half of them are now living in the neighboring country of Jordan.
We begin our World Watch segment with this special report from freelance reporter Russ Jones.
In Jordan, the sun rises not only on its own, but Iraqi refugees, many of them children. These are the casualties of war blending into the Jordanian culture we don't hear much about. They haven't been killed or wounded, but more than 2 million Iraqis have fled their country seeking a safe and secure place to raise their families. 9-year-old Gadir Hussein is one such child who has seen the devastation of war. She has studied English and various other subjects since leaving Iraq with her mother 4 years ago. Not knowing whether her father is dead or alive, she is among the thousands of refugees who've left Iraq and crossed the border into Jordan fleeing the escalation of violence.
I am glad I get to go to school and learn new things.
Once a teacher in Baghdad, Jackeen Mosner, who is also a Christian, now teaches at Baswell Community Center in Zarqa, Jordan, an informal education program operated by World Vision, where she helps Iraqi children try to overcome their experiences back home.
I always take them to what they feel. Why you are upset? What do you have? Did mommy, she don't have money to give you today? Did you take your lunch? You know, I let him to talk.
Some 2 million Iraqis have sought refuge in neighboring countries, fleeing the insecurity and violence of their homeland. Children are the most vulnerable among the war-affected population. There are an estimated 700,000 Iraqi refugees in Jordan, 200,000 school-aged children, 24,000 regularly attending school. The population of Jordan, 5.7 million. Some say Jordan plays the role of big brother to many of its neighboring countries due to its stability. Iraqis now account for more than 10% of the total population. Although the vast majorities are not confined in camps, most are denied legal status, meaning they can't legally work and provide for their families. In March 2007, World Vision declared Iraqi refugee crisis a Category 3 emergency. In September 2008, World Vision was formally recognized by the Jordanian government as an NGO.
World Vision's presence here started off more to meet the emergency needs of Iraqi refugees. It includes a large amount of advocacy. Sort of just meeting the immediate needs of the refugees.
Santo says this is the single largest displacement of persons World Vision has seen in the past half century, which poses a serious threat to the safety and well-being of innocent children and their families, and put the host country's services and infrastructure under severe pressure.
Of course, as the refugees stay here longer, they get poorer. Iraqis weren't poor to start off with. Most of the ones who came here weren't that poor, but they're getting poorer over time.
Many refugees who have found shelter in Jordan fear returning to Iraq to find their homes either destroyed or occupied by someone else. Convoys of returning Iraqis leave Amman once or twice a month, but the chance to go home rarely attracts more than a few dozen people.
There are many who do want to go back home, but there are a lot who are... they just had enough. It's violent and terrifying, and they've lost family members, and some are scared to go back.
Many of these children are a long way from the hot desert sand of Iraq, but it's here in Zarqa, at the World Vision Center, that these children are finding hope and purpose for a new day.
Most Iraqis work hard writing a new script for their lives. Children draw pictures to express the pain and anguish caused by war. While it was violence and terrorism that brought these Iraqis to Jordan, it is the love of God shared by World Vision teachers and volunteers to help put a new song in their hearts.
That was Russ Jones reporting from Jordan for CBN News. Thanks, Russ.
Continuing our World Watch report, we turn to Turkey, where a Muslim man is going to jail for stabbing a priest in Turkey. A Turkish judge there sentenced Ramzan Bay to 4.5 years in prison for the assault. Bay approached this priest, Father Adriano Fracini, after church in December 2007. He said he wanted to know more about Christianity, but when Fracini asked him if he wanted to convert, Bay stabbed him in the stomach. Bay claims he was influenced by a Turkish television show that portrays Christian missionaries as criminals. Meanwhile, the court case surrounding the torture and killing of these three missionaries drags on. It's been nearly 2 years since the men were murdered in Malatya, Turkey.
The Chinese government has paid a pastor $2,500 for the abuse he and his family suffered at the hands of police. China Aid Association reports Pastor Bike McSwan and his family were beaten and thrown out of their apartment in October. The money covers the medical bills of the pastor's youngest son, who was beaten the worst. It also covers the early termination of the family's rental agreement. CAA says the government paid the money because of international pressure.
Costa Rica is recovering from one of the strongest earthquakes to hit that small nation in the last 150 years.
The quake shut down some popular tourist attractions, leaving foreigners stranded and thousands of residents homeless. As Stan Jeter reports, the government and churches were quick to respond.
The 6.1 magnitude earthquake in the Central American nation of Costa Rica triggered massive landslides, shattering homes, destroying roads, and claiming the lives of at least 20 people.
The quake came, and I saw the two girls walking with their candy baskets. And then I didn't see them again. What could I have done? I couldn't do anything. Everyone here was screaming and crying, and they were stuck there.
The quake damaged 6 miles of road near the Poás volcano, a popular destination for tourists. President Oscar Arias toured the disaster area by helicopter, then went on national television to ask citizens to help with the recovery effort. He also asked the nation to pray.
I ask that we join together in prayer, regardless of our beliefs or religious denomination. I ask that we pray for the families of the victims, for those who are suffering from desperation, and also for the rescue workers and others working in the area. Even the poorest of Costa Ricans can give us a little of his faith.
Many Costa Rican churches have responded to the call by collecting food and other supplies for the hundreds of people left homeless by the quake.
I believe it is more blessed to give than to receive. And this is the moment that our brothers, with such an enormous needs, as we are seeing by television, we can respond.
Vanloads of food, blankets, and other supplies collected by the churches in the capital, San Jose, began navigating the treacherous roads toward the affected area within days of the quake. Many church members lost their homes and are now among the 2,000 living in temporary shelters. Stan Jeter, CBN News.